Have you been using basic text and now want to progress to using basic text bigger brother, Text Plus, which is completely free within DaVinci Resolve? Then this video is for you, as I'll guide you through it step by step.
First, make sure you're in the edit page by clicking this tab at the bottom. Now from here, if you'd like, you could just go ahead and add Text Plus to your timeline. However, you'd just be placing text on a boring black background, and well, that isn't very visually pleasing.
Personally, I'm going to add a nice background to my timeline first, and then add the Text Plus layer on top of it after, giving a better overall outcome, and I recommend you do the same.
Once you've downloaded the background of your choice, it's time to add it to the media pool. You can do this by pressing Command plus I on a Mac or Control plus I on a PC. From here, locate your background and go ahead and click Open. Now that your file has appeared in your media pool, simply click and drag it onto video track 1 on your timeline. Perfect. From here, if we come over to the left side of DaVinci, you'll see Toolbox. Click on the drop-down arrow beside it and it opens up a number of options, one of which is Titles, and this is what we want to select next. Once selected, you'll see the Titles menu appears to the right of it, and within that, a bunch of different titles appear. There's 6 titles in the top section, and then you have all of the Fusion titles in the section below that. I'll cover Fusion titles in another tutorial, but for this particular video, we want to come up again and select Text Plus just here, and then click and drag it above your background on your timeline. Great! When we've done this, the standard custom title text appears on top of our background, and the Text Plus window opens on the right hand side of DaVinci under the Inspector tab. You'll notice to the left of Text Plus there's a red toggle, and this indicates that it's been enabled. If I were to click on this again, it turns grey and the text disappears. So just make sure before we continue that it's turned on and you can see the custom title text over your background. If we come down under Text Plus, you'll see that there's 6 subsections, and they are Text, Layout, Transform, Shading, Image and Settings. You don't get all these added sections with basic text, so that's a big difference straight away. This tutorial is going to focus mainly on the text section, however, I'll be covering the other subsections in future videos, so keep an eye out for those.
Quick tip, while working through the text section, if you adjust anything such as buttons, sliders or values and you make a mistake, you can reset anything back to its default setting again. For example, hover over the word of the section you're at, in this case size, and when you double click it, it'll go back to its default setting, allowing you to start again. Wonderful!
Under text, the first thing you come to is the text box field containing the default custom title text. I'm going to change this to something that fits in with the type of background I'm using. As it's an image of a nice hammock, hanging between 2 palm trees on an empty beach, this screams relaxation to me. So I think a fitting word for this image would be relax, and that's what I'll change it to. Simply click anywhere within the text box and press Command or Control plus A, which will automatically highlight the existing text and then type your new word. So I've now got my new text appearing on my background image, and hopefully you do too. However, the current default font used doesn't really give off relaxing vibes, so I'm going to come down to font and change this by clicking on the drop-down arrow. You'll notice as you scroll down the list of fonts, your text will preview each one as you hover over it, which is great for finding one that suits quickly and saves time. You can also type the first letter of a font if you know which one you want, and it will display all the fonts to start with that letter, so you can locate it quicker. If I choose Futura, for example, underneath the font box, it allows you to select a different font style from that font family. It's currently set to bold, which makes the text appear thicker, though if you click on the drop-down arrow, this can be changed to the following styles, which changes the appearance of the text. Just to point out, not all fonts have extra styles, though when they do, they can open up more options for you.
It's worth noting that all fonts within DaVinci Resolve are free for personal use. However, not all are available for commercial use, so bear this in mind, especially if you're creating any content that you plan to monetize down the line, as this could get a copyright strike on your account or get the video taken down.
The font I'm going to select is called Mailand, which I downloaded from a website that's free for commercial use. As you can see, the style of this font is much better for my example and complements the background image. However, it's currently quite small and I'd like to scale it up a bit. To do this, you could come down to the size control and drag the slider to the right to make it larger, or, like I prefer to do, come up to the settings section here and then just use both the zoom and position controls until you get it looking just right for you. If you know the exact value to zoom in, you can type it in this field and then press enter, or you can simply click and drag the value to the left to get smaller and to the right to get larger until you see what works best visually, which I do personally. After adjusting the size of the text, I'd also like to adjust the position of it, so I'll now come down to the position X and Y controls. Adjusting the X axis moves the text horizontally, drag it to the left to move left, and drag it to the right to move the text right. Adjusting the Y axis moves the text vertically up and down, slide it to the left and the text goes down, and to the right and it moves up. I think it looks visually well around here, sitting nicely on top of the horizon line. Coming back into the title section again, you can also make your text pop a bit if you like, by adding a black shadow behind it. To do this, come up to the shading subsection here, and beside select element, click on number 3. You'll now see black shadow beside the word name. Underneath this, make sure to check enabled to turn this effect on, and now you'll see the shadow behind your text, making it pop. If you come down under properties, you can adjust the opacity to make it lighter or darker, depending on how much you'd like it to stand out. You can also change the position of the shadow by coming down to position and adjusting the X and Y offset until you get the result you're after. Happy days! Coming back to the text subsection now, the next option down is the color selector. To change this, click on the color box itself and it opens up this window. You can do a number of things to select the color you'd like to use. The first option is color wheel. You basically click and drag the little crosshair symbol over the color range until you get a color that fits well for you. You'll notice the color changes on the text in real time as you move it around. Fantastic! The next option you can select from the top is color sliders, which give you the option to select between grayscale, RGB, CMYK, and HSB values. You can play around with the sliders until you get a color you like. If you work in print, the CMYK option is good, as if you know the CMYK value, you can input it here and get your perfect color and then send it on to a commercial printer. Moving over to the next tab, you have color palettes. From the drop-down, you can select Web Safe Colors, Crayons, Developer, and Apple to give you a variety of different colors and shades to choose from. The next tab is called Image Palettes, and similar to the color wheel on the first tab, you can just click and drag the crosshair around until you get the color you'd like to choose. The last tab across is called Pencils, and as you can see, it just brings up a bunch of coloring pencils that you can just hover over and it tells you what the color is called, followed by clicking on the one that looks well to you and it will preview on your text. Wonderful! Once you've got the color you want, you can just go ahead and click OK, or if you'd like to save that color for use in other areas, you can click and drag the color into one of these empty slots, just here, and it will save that color so now it appears there every time you open the color box again. Another cool feature I use a lot here is the color picker tool, which looks like an eyedropper icon. If you click this, it allows you to select any color at all that's on the entire page in front of you. For instance, if you like this dark grey color of the DaVinci software itself, you could click it and the text is just turned to that shade of grey, which is pretty cool, as you aren't restricted to just the area within your viewer panel. For my example, I think I'm going to select a color from within my current image. I think this shade of orange looks quite well, and you'll notice the color box also changes to the color you've got selected as well. Moving down and we come to size. I briefly covered this earlier, but we opted to use the zoom controls instead. Essentially, this is another option to scale your text, from smaller by moving the slider to the left, and larger by moving the slider to the right. Under this is tracking, and it doesn't do what first comes to mind, such as tracking the text as it moves around the screen. In the graphic design world, tracking refers to the space between individual letters of a word. If you bring the slider to the left, the letters all start to bunch up and it makes it unreadable, so I wouldn't recommend going too extreme with this. If you bring the slider to the right, it will start to separate the letters apart from each other, with equal spacing between them. This could work for me as well, though for now, I'm happy with how it was. Next up, we have line spacing, which refers to the gap between rows of text. To show how this works, I'll first type another word in the text box underneath relax. Currently, there's a large gap in between the two words, and I can decrease or increase this easily using the line spacing control. Drag it to the left and the words get closer together, and drag it to the right and they get further apart.
We now come to anchor controls, which essentially align your text in predefined positions based on where the anchor point is. You can think of the anchor point as an invisible line that will adjust the text position and justification.
I've created a separate text plus layer and added a paragraph of text to show better how these controls work. You have the V anchor controls, which adjust the vertical alignment of the text to top, center, and bottom, and the H anchor controls, which adjust the horizontal alignment of the text to left, center, and right, like so. Under the physical V and H anchor buttons, you have the V and H anchor slider controls, and they essentially do the same thing as the buttons while giving you a bit of added control, as you can now move your text to an area in between the presets of the buttons. If I drag the slider of the V anchor left, I can set it to a point in between the top and center, and if I drag the slider right, I can set it in between the center and bottom, like so. Whereas the physical buttons only let you set your text at the predefined points the software has set up. Likewise, you can do the same with the H anchor slider, moving the text in between the left and center point and in between the center and right point, giving you a bit of added flexibility, though I personally don't think this looks visually pleasing when it's in between them. Lastly, in the anchor controls, we have V justify and H justify. V justify allows you to align your text evenly between the top and bottom edges of your text, almost acting like the line spacing option we looked at earlier. However, by default, when you move the slider to the right, nothing appears to happen. This is because for this control to work, we first need to come up to Layout beside the text subsection and change the type from Point to Frame from the drop-down menu. Now if we come back to the text section and slide the V justify to the right, you can see it expands the line spacing evenly as you drag the slider to the right. Bringing the slider back to the left closes the line spacing evenly again until you get back to the default setting of 0. Each justify lets you perform a full justification on your text, aligning it evenly along the left and right edges. However, as you can see in my example, this creates larger spaces between your text, especially between the words one and place at the bottom, which doesn't look great. So you may need to adjust some of your paragraph to make this work better for you. Let's come back up to layout and change the type back to point again. Coming down, we see direction. It's currently set to automatic. If you click on the drop-down arrow, it gives you four other options to set the direction of your body of text. Horizontal doesn't change anything as the text is already horizontal as it is. The other three options are reversed horizontal, vertical, and reversed vertical. Though as you can see when selecting these three options, they make the text not very legible, and I can only think you'd like to use these options in an art-like fashion. Moving down and we have line direction. Again, automatic is selected by default, and if you click the drop-down arrow you get two options, top-down and bottom-up. Top-down doesn't change anything as this is the way the text is as standard. If you select bottom up, it rearranges the first line of your sentence to the bottom of your paragraph and works its way up so that the last sentence is now at the top. Again, this wouldn't be used too often for readability reasons, but the option is there should you want to experiment with it. Next we have emphasis. This lets you put a strike through on your text or underline it or both if you really want. These tools are useful for highlighting sections of your text or areas that need corrected, which is useful to have. Now we come down to the really cool write on section, and this basically lets you perform a write on effect with your text.
I'll go back to my original background in text, as this effect will look and work better with a single word.
First, you want to drag your playhead to where you'd like your text to appear fully. So I'll just set mine to about here, and then come over and click the little keyframe to the right of write on. Now drag your playhead back to the start of your clip. After this, come up and drag the circle on the right side of the write on bar all the way to the left, just like this. And just like that, you have completed a write-on text effect. This effect looks particularly well when using a typewriter font. If you'd like your write-on effect to write off again at the end of your clip, you just do the opposite now. Drag your playhead to where you'd like the effect to start writing off, like this. Click on the keyframe again at the right-hand side, and then drag your playhead slider to the point where you'd like the effect to end. Lastly, drag the circle from the left side of the bar this time all the way to the right. Now if you play your clip from the beginning, you'll achieve a nice write-on, write-off effect, just like this. Great. That covers everything within the main text window, though as you can see, there's still two sub-menus at the bottom, which are Tab Spacing and Advanced Controls. If you click the drop-down arrow on Tab Spacing, you'll see three sub-options, Select Tab, Position, and Alignment. If you drag another text plus title onto your timeline and come up to the text box field and first press the Tab Space key on your keyboard, that looks like this symbol. This creates a new tab, and then for example, let's type in the summer months. June, July, and August, making sure to press the tab key before you type each month. Now if we come back down to tab spacing and make sure number 1 is selected, if we drag the position scroller left or right, you'll see that only the June tab is controlled. If you click on the number 2 and do the same, only July is controlled, and for number 3, August is controlled. Each number to the right of select tab corresponds to the amount of tabs you've created within the text box, up to a maximum of 8 tabs. If we come over to the transform icon with the drop-down arrow beside it, just under the viewer window, and click the arrow, we can select Fusion Overlay. This brings up dotted lines indicating the tabs you've created, and also a dotted circle with a vertical and horizontal arrow on it. You can hover over each of these elements and click and drag to move them within the viewer, rather than having to keep going down to the tab spacing controls. If you click on the small square between the two arrows within the circle, this allows you to move all of the text at once, while keeping the space between them the same as it was. If you click and drag the vertical arrow, this will only let you move the text up and down, locking the horizontal parameters, and likewise, if you click and drag the horizontal arrow, it will only let you move the text left and right, locking the vertical parameters. Coming back to the tab spacing menu, and now to the alignment section. We'll use the number 1 tab, which is June, to show how this works. Currently, the alignment is set to centered, as the circle dot is in the middle of the slider. If we drag the circle to the left, the tabbed line will align to the left of the first letter of the word. And if we drag it to the right, the top line will align to the right of the last letter of the word. This control works the same for all of the tabs.
Tab spacing can be useful for organization, especially for creating lists, sections, and categories. So why not go ahead and make your next to-do list?
The last section in this area is advanced controls, and the first option we come to is reading direction. It's set at automatic as default, and if you click the drop-down arrow, you have two other options below this. There's the standard left to right option, which works for the majority of languages. However, below this, you have the option of right to left for the languages that read this way, such as Arabic, Hebrew, and Kurdish. So it covers everyone that wants to use DaVinci, which is great. Under this, we have force monospaced, which sounds a bit futuristic, though basically it controls the kerning or space between the characters of a word or words if you like. It's also based on your selected font's kerning settings, so using different fonts can have different outcomes. Personally, when using this feature on the mainland font, it doesn't look great at all, as it seems to adjust the spacing between the individual characters in an uneven fashion, which isn't visually pleasing at all. If I wanted to adjust the kerning of this font, I would just come up to the tracking slider and adjust this instead, as it gives a much better outcome in this case. Next we have use ligatures, and ligatures in simple terms are when two or more letters are joined together to make what's called a glyph. You've most likely seen this fancy text I created at some point or another, especially for combining the letters FF and FL for example. If you click on the drop down arrow, you'll have the default option of non-Latin. This would apply ligatures to any fonts that have the ability to create them, providing they aren't Latin fonts. We also have the option of none, so even if a font you're using supports ligatures, but you would rather the letters don't join up together, you can just turn ligatures off completely this way, and it would just put a standard space between the two letters. The remaining option in this menu is all scripts. This basically enables ligatures on all fonts that have the ability to create them, regardless of the fonts being Latin or non-Latin. If you love your ligatures, this is the way to go. There's a little checkbox underneath this called Style Can Split Ligatures. If the font you're using has the ability to do this, you can just check it on from here, and this would give you the option of keeping some ligatures as glyphs and splitting others that you don't want attached together. For the next option, I've created another text plus title with some text. Coming down the list, and next we have Stylistic Set. Certain fonts have different styles for certain letters that you can use within them. For example, Open Sans. It's currently set to none, but if you click on the drop down arrow, this opens up Stylistic Set 1, 2 and 3. Each has its own style, though for this example sentence I've created, if we select Stylistic Set 1, you can see that the standard letter G has now changed to a differently styled letter G, while the rest of the letters stay the same and keep all their properties. Pretty cool. Under this we have font features. Again, this is a feature that's built into some fonts, but not all of them. There's a list of tags that can be put into this text field. I'll include the link within the description so that you can access all of them.
However, on the fonts I tried, I couldn't get these features to work. So if any of you have any better luck, please let me know in the comments, as it would be interesting to check this out.
The very last section within Advanced Controls is Manual Kerning and Manual Positioning. If we jump into the Fusion page quickly by clicking this icon at the bottom, it's easier to show how this works. We can also access all the same features of the text section within here too. If we come up to the row of icons just above the viewer and click on the second button across called Allow Manual Positioning, we can actually adjust the position of each separate character, like so. In this exaggerated example, the kerning and positioning I've adjusted doesn't look great at all, so I can click and drag over an individual letter to select it, shown by the red brackets above and below it, and then just come down and click on the Clear Selected button here, which will reset it to the starting position within the text. If I want to just reset all of the text I adjusted, I can just click on the Clear All button here, and as you can see, it's all snapped back together as it was. The ability to adjust single characters' positions and kerning can open up a lot of stylistic options for you, which is pretty cool, especially if you're in the field of graphic design.
Hopefully you learned something new today, and if you'd like to learn more about DaVinci Resolve, make sure to check out the rest of my videos. Have a great day, folks.